Good morning, everyone. Last night was the Perth Pride Parade. And I spent the entire night shouting until about midnight, so my voice has been somewhat affected by this, as has my level of energy. This video is about the phonological oddities of the North Germanic languages, Norwegian, Swedish, Danish, shit like that. Let's start with Swedish and Norwegian. A feature that you don't commonly find in European languages are retroflex consonants. They're very common in other places in the world, particularly the Indian subcontinent and the Australian continent. Those places have got a wealth of retroflex consonants floating around, but in Europe, for some reason, you just don't find it as much. But two languages that you do find it, and there's probably more, are Norwegian and Swedish. Basically, alveolar consonants which have an R before them are allophonically made retroflex.
Gubbarna, får de lite förtur i hörnan nu? Förtur. Annars blir det. Om de inte sköter så blir det en förtur.
On top of that, you've got an often confusing-looking sound, which is the Danish soft D. And on paper, it's kind of similar to English the. And in practice, it's kind of similar to English la. So what the fuck is it? I'll play some examples of it now so you can kind of get your ears around it.
Sisse og Frede sidder midt i en park ved siden af en mand. Manden sidder og kigger på billeder på nettet, men de to synes det meget federe at sidde og nyde ud.
You might be thinking, that's a bit of a weird sound. I wonder where it came from. None of the neighboring languages have that sound. Its origins are another place in which the soft D is similar to English the. Basically, in all places where the soft D now is, there used to be a regular D sound, but it got lenited. In other words, it got weakened in certain positions in a word, particularly at the ends of words. In English, you have Old English fader and then Modern English father, which is because the regular D sound before R got weakened into a the. Now that I think about it, a better example would be how in English we have the word bord, but in Welsh we have bwrdd. Sorry that I can't pronounce Welsh. You can see how in English we've got a final d sound, but in Welsh that d has softened to a the. That's the same thing what's happened to get the soft d in Danish. Next is something that people freak out about a lot when talking about Danish phonology, and that Danish is a really fucking weird language. But another thing that people freak out about a lot about Danish is the stød. Just to be perfectly clear, I am using the English velar l to approximate the soft d here. If you don't like that, then kill me. Just find me, just track me down and fucking stab me in the chest. Basically, stød originated as a sort of glottalization in certain Old Norse words. I don't fully understand the processes through which stød originated, so I can't talk in depth about them, but I'm pretty sure it comes from Old Norse words that just had one syllable.
Not including the definite article, which is sort of an affix or ecliptic in modern Danish. At the time, that was a separate word in Old Norse, and so you'll still find disyllabic words in Danish which have stød because the definite article got added on as an extra syllable after the sound change happened.
Either way, monosyllabic words in Old Norse tend to result in stød having words in modern Danish. And the way that stød is expressed, even though on paper it's a glottalization, there's not actually any glottal closure. You know, the air doesn't stop flowing while people are pronouncing a word with stød, and so it comes out more of like a creaky voice, like vocal fry, or as kind of laryngealization. The expression of stød does vary regionally. For example, in southern Jutland, I hope that that's how I approximate that pronunciation. In southern Jutland, the stød has actually evolved into a pitch accent more similar to Swedish and Norwegian. And in western Jutland, you've got something called V-stød, which is basically an extra stød. You know, it's stød appearing in words that standard Danish doesn't have stød in. And I think it evolved from, you know, consonant clusters being eroded away, but I really don't know. I didn't.
The historical linguistic kind of stød is not as complicated than the sound itself. And knowing my qualifications in linguistics are just a kind of passion for it, it seemed like I might not be qualified to try and read through all historical linguistics and try and recite it to you because I can easily misunderstand shit and get shit wrong.
My favorite oddity of Northern Germanic phonology is ingressive speech. I'm going to make a video about this at some point, but in certain parts of the world, ingressive speech is used in a particular way. People will sometimes speak while inhaling, which is called ingressive speech. And so the context in which people speak ingressively in the Northern Germanic-speaking countries varies from place to place. In some places, people don't do it at all. In other places, people will inhale certain words, like yes and no words. They'll inhale them. There's people in Canada who do it. There's people in Scotland and Northern England who do it. It's common in various places sort of around the North Atlantic and the North Sea. In certain places in Sweden, they don't even inhale the word ja. They just inhale a little slurping noise, and that's their little like affirmative sound. And I've heard tell of people in Iceland speaking, you know, saying whole sentences ingressively. I would absolutely kill for it to be socially acceptable for me to speak ingressively whenever I felt like it. Then there is my least favorite component of Swedish phonology, which is the funny sound. The amount of money that the Swedish government must pay to keep this letter in the IPA every year has got to be so fucking much. Why would you ever need this symbol? Not only is the sound only in one language, but it also doesn't really appear as that form in that language. It appears as various other sounds which have their own letters already. On paper, this sound is pronounced as sha, but that's not how people say it. I've read that in Finland it's pronounced as sha or sha, in Sweden it's pronounced as sha or maybe even sha.
Machine.
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 Machine
to machine.
Machine to machine.
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 It originates from consonant clusters of s and k right next to each other, which is the same origin as the sh sound in English. In some contexts, it's complicated. But yeah, the sk to sh sound change in English reflects the sk to sh sound change in Swedish. And now we go on to the weirdest feature, and probably the least discussed one, which is the, I don't know how Swedish people would pronounce this, maybe as Viby, but I'm going to pronounce it as Viby because I think that's funny. The strangest sound in Swedish phonology by far is the Viby-I. Here's some examples of people saying it in Swedish.
Här är kriminologi.
Normalt industriell ekonomi på LTH. Men nu läser jag en termin praktisk filosofi.
And here's some examples of Swedish people using it while speaking English.
Having claimed the lives of 3 million people worldwide.
Everyone was fed up and decided to leave or hide.
Basically, instead of pronouncing the long E sound as E, they pronounce it as something like E or E or something like that. And you might be wondering, Raya, why the fuck does it sound like that? And it's all to do with something that, again, one day I'm going to make a video about, which is the concept of compensatory acoustics. I don't know if that's the proper term for it, I just made that up, but it sounds right. It's the same concept that allows Americans to pronounce R as R instead of R. Sure, the articulation between R and R is drastically different, but the actual sound that comes out, the difference is almost imperceptible between them. And so that allows for people in America to have a free variation between the two sounds and how they articulate them, because it doesn't really have an impact on how they're understood. And in Sweden, the E sound can be substituted for a weird little E sound, because my impersonation of that is probably really bad, but I'm trying my best here. That substitution can be made because even though it's articulated completely differently and it sounds noticeably different, there's still not much ambiguity caused by it. People can still be understood perfectly well. In fact, it even seems to be a prestige feature. The sound basically holds prestige in some way. And that, of course, means that people are inclined to, if they pronounce E as E, they're inclined to change their pronunciation to E because it's a prestige feature of speech. And so the sound seems to be spreading out from cities like Stockholm, where Viby-I is almost universal, and it seems to be spreading northward and into other parts of Sweden from there because of the prestige that it holds. So yeah, that was my video on the oddities of Northern Germanic phonology. Even though I pretend to be pissed off by some of them, I still find these really interesting. And I think that a lot of them are very unique and very fascinating. Even though the fucking Swedish IPA letter is bullshit, I refuse to back down from that. I'm wearing my fucking shirt backwards. I just realized that. Oh. Yeah, no, it doesn't really have a tag, but that's the tag. I'm wearing this fucking shirt backwards. Have a nice rest of your week. Or probably 2 weeks, because I only upload every 2 weeks. Have a fucking bye. I still don't have a fucking outro, just bye. Oh, wow, that was a terrible voice crack to end on. All right, I'm still recording, so let me say that again.
Bye.
There we go, that was much better.